So, I guess I'll explain a little bit about what I'm going to do here. Don't tell anybody out there in the machining world, but I'm kind of a closet woodchuck. Actually, I was into woodworking before I got into metalworking. And my hobbies have just sort of evolved and blending together because pattern making is really all about being a good woodworker. So anyway, so we've got some planes here and a hand saw, and I got power tools I could use, but it's 1 in the morning right now, so I'm pretty sure my wife and neighbors wouldn't appreciate that so much. Here's the material I think we're gonna use. And I don't know, this one here is pretty beat up, scarred up, but maybe we can work with that. But this was just, scrap laying around the shop. And kind of drew up a little plan here. I got enough wood here. I kind of measured it. And I can make 2 5-inch wide pieces. There's some knots and stuff up here. Woodworkers in general hate knots. And absolutely, especially in a pattern, because the wood will swell on the long grain this way, but the knot, of course, the long grain's going that way, so you're gonna get some weird shape in your part just depending on as the humidity changes. So don't put knots in your parts. It'd make life a lot better. Anyway, it's gonna be 5 inches wide and oh, excuse me, 5 inches wide and 5 inches tall. We've got some 3/4-inch wood here. See how much is left after we're done cleaning it up, but it should be more or less 3/4. And then I'm gonna put a single gusset in the middle of it. And I'm gonna do like a stop dado in here that it'd be really easy to just use a on the table saw a dado cutter and just hog out a groove all the way through, but when you leave that opening in the top, well, you gotta fill it with something. So I'm putting some kind of putty or bondo or something like that in there, or you can try to make the wood fit in there, but then you run into that same distortion that happens, when the if you're gonna have long grain running two different ways. I mean, it'll hold together fine and everything like that, but there goes my razor. But anyway, like I said, maybe I'm just too particular. So that's the plan. And measured this thing here. This board is, oh, not quite 6 inches wide, I think. Oh, excuse me, not quite 7. It's 5 3/4 of an inch wide. So I guess that's going to be, oh, after it gets done machining and everything like that, it'll be, more or less 5 by 6 1/2 or something like that. So anyway, let me set the camera up here and we'll cut this thing up. Right. Well, it's always a good idea to use a little bit of paraffin wax on the saw. Makes things cut a little bit easier. Let's see how this saw here behaves. I think there's an issue with this thing. I need to probably go through and sharpen it up again. I hope you can see the line, but I got a line right here, so I'm gonna, normally people will just drag it back, and that's really something you would do with like a big crosscut saw, an old carpenter's type saw, but this one here, that's not necessary. That's cutting pretty good, actually. Warped a little bit. you can see the knots here. I pretty much got them all out, except there's a little bit right there. Well, that's all right. We'll get that there in an upcoming step. All right. So that's probably not super exciting for y'all, so I think I'm going to go ahead and turn the camera off, and I'll cut this in half right here, and then we'll get on to the next step. All right, so this is a saw cut edge here. I'm going to just clean it up a little bit here with my smoothing plane, because that just ain't good enough. It's actually pretty rough there. But it doesn't take much here, and we're sure not removing very much here. Well, miles by machinist standards probably, but not enough to make any difference here. Check that out. Find a square here. Guess I can't find one when I need one. Here I'll have to do. Prepare it underneath the light. Looks like we're leaning. This side here is just a little bit high. Now the trick to that is the blade doesn't go clear to the edge, so you take one or two slices kind of riding on that edge, that'll cut it over, and then take a full cut, so let's have a look at it again, see if it's nice and square. Ah, perfect, can't see any light through the end. Alright, let's clean up this one here. Let's see, that edge is bad, so I'm gonna kind of feeling for the direction of the grain. Really, some, you know, if you're running into the end of the end grain, a lot of times it'll feel coarser going one way or the other, but that must be pretty much running parallel, so let's clean that up a little bit. Certainly a lot more pleasurable to listen to this than a planer, or joiner, or whatever you might be using. Okay, now we're same problem, but the other direction. So I'm gonna do it on this side now. One cut to smooth it. Didn't quite get it all. There. Nice full cut. Width shavings are nice. Alright, so those ones there, nice and flat. We'll get it to lay close together there. Yeah, that'll work. Switch them around. We've got kind of a little, just a littlest bit of a cup. Cutting the board in half, you know, if you've got a cup that's kind of like this, cut the board in half, well, automatically you've lost half that cup. So we did that to some extent here, so it doesn't have very much of a cup. Not enough that I'm going to be too worried about it here. That looks good. So now put them both in here. Into the camera. Alright. Now, this one here is a lot taller than the other one, so in fact, it's a whole lot. So I'm going to use, just for kicks here, this is a scrub plane. And you see how big the opening on that is, and the blade's got a curve? This thing is, hand tool shop, you don't have power tools, but that thing really gets it done. You can see how thick that shaving is. and it could take a much bigger ceiling if you really wanted to. This is heavy removal tool. I've already almost got rid of that knot. See the grain's tearing a little bit here. It's switching back because of that knot. Not too much I can do about that, I suppose. That's just about got that all the same height, so now we'll go back to the smoothing plane. You can hear it skip because it's not flat. Side here. So. Couple of swipes. Still high. Throw a rule on here just to make sure it's parallel. Let's see what we got here. What? That is spot on at 5. Perfect. Closer than that. Not with this kind of tooling. Alright. So we got these two faces parallel. Now what we need to do, I would really probably rather do this on the table saw, but now we'll save because I want to miter it. If I put a miter joint on here, then the seam will be right at the corner. And instead out here, and again, you get that weird distortion from humidity. If it was a piece of furniture, it wouldn't matter at all, but since we're trying to build a pattern, and honestly, really, even that it's a pattern, it probably still don't matter. All right. We got that. I suppose maybe we ought to figure out exactly how we're going to cut our box data. Okay, I'm gonna cut away for now and we'll come back and we'll check that out. Okay, so I've done a little bit of layout work on here and you can see that I've got a rectangle here and it stops up here about a half inch away from the end of that. And the way we're gonna do this, I'm gonna chop into this here with a chisel down here at the end and take out a little chip. And then we're gonna use a saw. We're gonna saw down these lines on both sides. And then probably we'll use the router plane here. This has got depth adjustment, so we'll cut down a quarter inch, I guess, maybe it'd be about right. We'll So, get the mallet. This was a really nice mallet, and then my dog got a hold of it and, you know, had lunch. So hopefully, you guys can see what I'm doing here. I'm just putting this on the line here for right now. Actually, just a touch away from it. So, of course, because this has a bevel, as it drives into the wood, it pushes forward and crushes the fibers a little bit. So, as a general rule, you don't want to start right on your line. Usually, your lighting is terrible. I'm sorry, I'm going to have to turn away from you for a second here. Okay, there's that one. Here at the end. This ain't really critical, just cut it all. But what we want to do is get in there and then we can cut out a little bit of a chip. That way when we run our saw down in here, it's got somewhere for it to terminate into. Wiggle this here out a little bit. When we're down at least far enough. One of the guys at work just gave me so much trouble because this set of chisels, I think this was. $500, I want to say, for this set of chisels. But I bought a set of chisels from Craftsman. In fact, I got one of them right here. One of these here. And I think a set less, you know, maybe like six or eight of them or something, was like $50 or more, maybe even. I tell you what, don't buy this chisel if you ever have the chance, because steel is just absolutely terrible. It's not very hard, it won't hold an edge very long. These are Lee Nielsen. I have no affiliation with them, but they make very good quality tools. No doubt somebody makes a better one than this, but these ones are really good. Guys out there are into woodworking also. I'm sure there's more than a couple out there. I kind of switched to a narrower chisel here because it's just a little bit easier to get in between the, you know, that's half inch and this is, I don't know, 16th less or something, which just gives me a little bit of room to wiggle. More room. Extra room is always handy here. You can always make this stuff bigger, but if you have to try to make it smaller again, it's considerably harder. Not impossible necessarily, but. Thank you. help stabilize this part, make it stronger, because that miter joint that I'm going to put in there is probably not, that's not the strongest way to do it. It will give good results for what we're trying to do. But putting this rib in here will help kind of reinforce that too. When I'm done, I may drill it and put some nails in there. Strong fasteners like you would think a nail is, like hammered in tight, but just something to pin everything together. Okay, so what I'm doing right now, because I want this to be a really accurate cut, right? So I'm just cutting out a little notch here. I hope that's in frame. Let me just look. Make sure. In frame, but I suppose you probably can't really see. But anyway, so I'll cut out a little bit of a notch here right on the line. Then I can get my saw blade started in that little cut. I have so the blade don't go jump off onto the line on me. Frugal with this wood, there's a little chip in this corner right here. Since I have to bevel stuff here anyway, I made sure that my dado where the joint is going to be is right where that bevel needs to go. Tool here. Boy, they got really nice handles. That is a really super comfortable handle. I mean, it's fancily sawn and everything like that too, but I need to move my light. Hope it's not blinding the camera. Set this blade. Thing about this is it's got this little ring, so you can actually lock the depth once you've got it. Get my ruler out, pencil dull, no problem, I got a pencil sharpener real handy here. Chisels get used for everything in the shop. Sharpening your pencil, sharpening lines, helping to get splinters out. Okay, I was looking for the ruler. So that's a quarter inch deep. Then I'm going to set it, and I can use this to draw the line. Lock the depth top. that in a few passes when we get to it tonight. Now I can use this as a marking tool to mark the bottom of my saw cut. That way I don't saw it too deep. It's been quite a while since I've been out here doing this sort of work. I forget what I'm doing. And I've got marking gauges. I could easily have done it with a marking gauge, but I'm going to use that tool. I like that line. Use that tool to make this cut anyway, so I set up two tools to do one job. Can't win. Think like put wax on here, you can be rubbing wax all over everything in there and it's gonna spoil your glue joints, but I've really got no explanation why, but you just have to take my word. It does not spoil the glue joint. Probably most of it gets removed in the process of cutting anyway. It all ends up in the sawdust or something, I guess. Technique here is actually very much the way that they would have built stair treads. Somewhere I've got one.
Where is it?
Well, anyway, I've actually got a stair saw, which is meant for sawing these dados out. But that one is in really poor condition. Some of this. pretty job on that, something like this. Once the piece is glued in there, you'll never see it. Now there is sort of a tendency for a lot of nostalgia about the way that work used to be done back in the old days. You know, they worked at such high degrees and stuff, but that is not always true. I've seen examples in museums and stuff where backs of chair legs and things like that were just cut out with a hatchet. The front looked really good and everything like that, but you know, nobody was looking at the back of the legs. So why spend all day sanding them? One stop dado. Half inch. You know what? Actually, handle the kind of a gauge block here. Let's see if the half inch fits in there. It's a little tight. All right, we got room to do a little fitting. So I would much rather be too tight than too loose. All right, well, that's it for that step. I'll go ahead and finish this other one up, and we'll get on to the next part. Okay, so off camera, what I've done here, I took this little stick here, and I cut a couple of pieces, and I planed a little wedge onto them because I wanted these two to sort of stay. I want that dado to stay in line when I do some more cutting here. What we need to do, if you remember, this is going to be standing vertically here, one of these. What I need to do, and you'll see how this works later, but these edges on the side, I need to put draft on them. Kind of drew a little line here on this, so I didn't. Hopefully, I don't mess up when I cut it. Anyway, so it's daytime now, so I can run the power tools. I'm gonna set up my table saw, and we'll come back to that in just a minute. Alrighty, we got the table saw set up here. It's plugged in. I've got the saw blade tilted that direction, I believe 3 degrees. And you know, usually about 1.5 degrees is all you need, but I want this part to come out really easy. Since this edge is probably going to end up getting machined off anyway, it won't really matter that much. Okay, here we go. Cover your ears, maybe loud. All right, that's it for the draft. I gotta put a rip blade in here. Do that off camera, and then we're gonna do some bubbling here. We're all set up here. Saw blade's tipped over at 45 degrees. Make sure I miter it to where the dados to the inside. That would really be bad to do it the other way. All right, here we go. Oh, I guess I better plug the saw in first, huh? Never have to plug in my handsaw. All right, here we go again. See how this fits up. Looks like it ought to work. Proportions look pretty good. Okay. Alright, well, it wouldn't be a workbench if it didn't get cluttered up a little bit. Alright, so the parts here. And this piece needs to be. Okay, the dado is 4 inches. I want it to come up past it, so we'll go with 4 1/4. That should be plenty good enough. Alright. That side are there already. Okay. So I want the long grain to end up being the part that sits. Let's set this together here for you. I want the long grain to be running between here and there because it'll be easier to. I need to plane a taper on here. So that's what I'm gonna do. Alright, then to get my bevel gauge set up here, 45. I need to tighten some stuff. It's a good thing I stopped because I was fixing to mark it out wrong, but that's all right. I figured it out now. Okay, so what I'm going to do, since, oh, you know what? Are we marking it out wrong again? I think we are. Okay, what we actually need is 4 1/4 inches running this way here at 45. Together. Okay. Come on. Suppose I could have just marked that. That line there. It's at 45. Come to this side. This way here. We can get it marked at 4 1/4 inches here. It's gonna work. Yeah, I don't know. I'm not digging that so much. Maybe this way's better. Maybe that'll make 4 1/4 inches. No, I don't. Just have to go with it the way it is, I guess. We'll just lay it out the other way and have to deal with. Cutting it to make it fit, I suppose. Alright. So, cross cut that. Alright. So because I want an accurate cut, I'm gonna give myself a nice chisel notch to get into. And my smaller saw won't saw deep enough, so I'm gonna have to use a full-size handsaw here. Try not to bump the camera while I'm doing this here. Vice made by the Veritas company in Canada. I think that they have discontinued making this vice now, though. It's a copy of an old, an antique one, and they're expensive. This one was expensive. Boy, it's bouncy stuff. This is a number 12 Diston. If I can read it. The light's not very good in here right now, but if you ever see saws that have this little thing here, it's called a nib. And there's a lot of theories as to what they're for, but their advertising literature says it's just ornament. They stopped putting these on, I forget exactly what year, but during the Depression, so this saw is, I don't know, pretty old. It's from the 30s or so, probably, you know. And it's a lot better than most of the saws you can find nowadays. The blade's polished. There's all kinds of nice features on there that, you know, they're really not obvious, but once you get to it, they're very useful. Alright. Now what I need to do, let's see, how to go about this. What I need to do is, this piece needs to get tapered towards this edge. Right? I think I'll do that after I've cut it loose. What we're gonna need is some rabbets cut into the edge of this here. So that may actually be a pretty good job for the table saw. Or at least we can, I think we could probably do it on the table saw. We've got a sled. Hold that piece on there, probably. Let's see. That way. Do that one. Well, maybe not. It's going to be kind of a hard thing to hold. Well, maybe if I just do it right now, before I cut it off. The only thing is, this thing's bowed pretty crazy. Alright. Give me a minute. We'll figure this out. We're back out here at the table saw, so we're going to knock that off, and since I got to do some long grain cuts, I'll just leave this blade on here for a minute. We'll handle the long grain, and then we'll switch the blade out again, we'll go back to the crosscut blade. Check the depth of my slots here. cut all the way down to the mark. Okay, that's a quarter inch. So what we need to do here, come over a quarter of an inch. We need about a quarter of an inch. The board is right on at 3/4. So that one's doing right at 3/4. We need a 1/2 inch tenon left over when we're done. So we're going to go just a little bit below and then we'll measure what we've got. Then when we're done, we'll once we got the height set, we won't change that. Scale has actually got it's a centering ruler, so you can say you need a part centered at some odd weird number or whatever, but say if you want 2 inches, you can set it to read 2 inches right here, and then there's at 50%, there's 2 inches listed right there, so you can find the center of something really quick. Leaving a fuzzed edge. Uh-oh. Oh, we done messed up. I just realized this is a 1/2 inch wide groove. Well, is a little bit shorter, huh? Gonna have to fix that. Well, that's the way it goes. Make it and see how it works, I guess. So what I really need to do is come up 1/8 of an inch, not a quarter. So we gotta go down. So what we get here now. Pretty good. Now we need to come over where we're 1/4 inch deep. Make sure not to measure this step too. Get a pencil. quarter. I suppose that's why you're supposed to measure twice, huh? So I'm going off the measure twice, cut once method. Measure once, cut twice. Extra there. See what I, oh, turn this. See what happens over here on this other edge, huh? Okay, I'm gonna cut away
back. You know, I think instead of going with the rip blade, just because I got the height just right and everything, this is gonna be a joint buried inside of it anyway. Let's take a look here and see what we get, what kind of results we get cross cutting with a rip blade. Just touch the edge with it there. Let's see what we get. Bad results. Alright. Let's get this offset a quarter inch. And cut that. If I had not screwed up earlier, I could have just left most of my adjustments the same, and now I gotta move everything around. Nice thing about this too is this makes a flat bottom cut. A cross cut, it doesn't. Alright, here we go. Leave very much. Well, that's the way it goes, I suppose. What we'll have to do now we're gonna have to in this corner here, or excuse me, out here at these corners, because this is gonna be where it hits over here, it's gonna be overhanging. We're going to have to saw out a little bit of this tenon. We'll go do that in the shop and get out in sunlight. Alright, this ain't very critical. We're just making some relief. I didn't quite get the bottom down with that. Give myself a good line. A little starting nick here with the chisel. Takes a little time, it's really easy. Okay, cross cut. Hmm.
enough back. Bring it up a little bit. Enough. Yet I'm still fussing with it. Right. Other parts. One side's a little tighter than the other. Alright, well, we'll go ahead and we'll leave this along here. What? It really is tight. Yeah. It's alright, we've got ways of fixing that too. Okay. Here. Cutting into the end grain here, so this is actually a rip cut. So I have a little dovetail saw here matched to my cross cut saw. Can't just pop that waste out. Get a saw on it. Use the cross cut here. That up. Oh, wrong spot. Okay. That'll come together. Just need to fit the joints a little bit. No big deal. Now we need to cut this waste off once we're done working with that. And then we'll plane the taper on here. And I sure hope I got enough room to make the taper out of that. I should have probably made this a little thinner. My router plane is, you know, it's only so wide, so it's got to be a certain amount. Alright. Enough yakking. Start here because we're starting right on a point. So I'm going to have to use that big handsaw again. Actually, you know what? We can do this now. We're gonna go to the bench hook and see if we can't hold this thing down some other way. Alright, we're back at the bench hook here. So I don't need my safety glasses for this operation. Alright, I'm gonna take this tool here, it's called a striking knife. We're gonna get a nice little line started there. Deepen it a little bit. And we're gonna score that with a chisel. I put a little, slapped a little notch in there real quick to try to help me.
I don't know how well it's going to work, but let's see what we get. Let's start from this side. I can kind of ride in that groove a little bit. If you guys are interested in woodworking at all, there's a guy, he used to be the editor for a popular woodworking magazine, but he's really into hand tool work. And he has a whole system of, wow, that's really splitting out bad. It's a good thing we got to put a taper on there already, huh? Good enough groove to follow with the saw. Carcass saw. It's not really a carcass saw. This is a saw that came out of an old miter box probably at some point. Remove the drain. Before I knock it over into the saw. Wanted to use this because this makes a much nicer, nice smooth cut. Shouldn't even need to plane it probably when I'm done. Smell that pine. There we go. Is that good? All right. Well, you can see, but that's a pretty good quality cut right there. Not bad at all. Now, I think my plan to cover up my dado completely is sort of a little bit ruined here, but we're gonna have to put a fillet into this anyway, so there's gonna be some putty gotta go there anyway. All right, before I put this thing in the vise, I'm going to lay it flat in between these jaws, but that's awfully pointy, so I don't really want to tear up my leather, so I'm going to kind of just chamfer this off a little bit. I'll be a little bit kinder to the leather in there. Won't really be losing any strength, that's right in the corner anyway, so. Alright, I'm gonna have to slide this back just a hair. Alright, maybe it might not go much, we'll see. It's in there good and solid. Now, remember that this is the side that needs to be the thinnest, so let's put some lines on here so you can kind of see what's happening. So what I'm going to do, I think, I've got this thing here, and I'll just start planing on this edge a little bit. Well, you know what, that's going to be a cross grain, where actually the grain is running this way. It's a lot better if I flip it around. I'll be planing in the wrong direction. And that's probably gonna tear out some grain. That's in there good. see bevel I'm putting on here. Setup we could ever have. If you wanted to get real fancy, you could, you know, if you were going to make a whole bunch of these, maybe set up a block of wood and cut a shape into it, wedge it into it, kind of the way I held these pieces together, and then you could clamp it down to your bench top, work on it. Taper on that. We could get more up there still yet, though. Okay. I think that's good on that side. Taper on it. Now we'll do this side. That's playing with the grain there, so. Swipe there is kind of a step. So now what we want to do, square corners are bad for pattern making. We got to round that up. So we'll just put that back in the vise here. Right here. Use a some of the green. That's alright. Again, there's going to be some filler going to have to go into those places anyway. Alright, so that piece is pretty much done. Yeah, I just got a little bit of sanding on here, but I won't bore you with that. I hate to have to even bore myself with it, but somebody's got to do it, I guess. Well, I'm bound and determined to put that thing in there the wrong way. Okay, so that's going to fit like that. This piece right here. Let's see. Well, you know, probably the easiest way is to take a little touch off of this, maybe. That's a good fit. Oh, yeah, that one there is actually a pretty decent fit too. So we're going to leave it just like that. Alright, so I'm going to put a witness mark on here. That one goes there. And there. That's two marks. It goes there. Alright. Because now we can glue her up. Alright. Got it all sanded down. Guess we're ready to glue it back together. Well, glue it together. And put myself a little... what do they call that? A witness mark right here on this. And as long as this piece goes back where that witness mark is, and you know, everything will be in the same orientation. Probably don't really matter, but just a good practice, I guess. And I made sure to sand everything really nice and smooth. I had a couple of dents. Where was it at? Oh, they're right here. They're right there. And I just put a couple of drops of water on there and let it soak in for a minute. And then I just kind of heated it up with this torch. And the water soaks into the wood fibers and boils, and that forces the fibers back up. It was actually a pretty good dent, and hey, I got them out. Good enough for this. Once we're done, we're going to put some sandable primer on there, and that'll fill in any really little fine defects, but we're doing pretty good. Alright, so first thing, pull that out of there, and I want this miter to lay together really nice, right? Who doesn't want their miters to fit nice? So, trick for doing that, actually I probably should stick this thing in here so that it registers it good. So I'm going to make this part a little bit harder, but so the trick, yeah, alright, anyway.
trick is use some tape. This is just painter's tape. It's got a soft glue. So it won't get stuck on there forever. I put it on here. And close. Put tape on it. This side. And then that'll make a hinge. And put some glue on there, and then we hinge it shut. And it'll actually make the tape tighten up just a little bit too once you fold it. I was trying to stretch this tape. So it'll pull it together real nice and tight. There we go. Alright. Let's see how that goes. Oh yeah, see it? It doesn't even want to shut. Maybe it's too tight. There we go. Oh yeah, see it? It wants to spring open. But now we can just glue it like that. Set this guy in there. Okay, make sure we got all our stuff. Got some Tibon glue here, number 3. It's a waterproof one. Probably don't really need waterproof here, but it's just what I have on hand. Buying these popsicle sticks at the craft store for doing stuff like this. They're, I don't know, $1 for 100 of them or something. And then when it's done, you just throw it away. I've even used these little popsicle sticks as places to make a boss on patterns, you know, if you need just a little very thin raised up section. Works really good for that. Okay. This is good to make sure sometimes you get like a little pocket of air kind of under the glue, like right there. You can actually have problems with your joint because of that. When it starts to soak into the wood, it'll not be bound there. You know, you want it to all be connected real good. We don't want to put a ridiculous amount of glue on there, but we want enough. So get a little bit on there too, I guess. Building a piece of furniture here. This really is not critical for high strength. Get some glue down here. Over here. Minute working window on this particular glue where it starts to bind or seize. So we should be fine here. That's one of the advantages of this over the original Tibon. It sets fast, which is good if you just need to fit something up quickly. You know. You you can even do what's called a rub joint. Take the two parts, fit them together, and taken. Now, for lack of a better clamp at hand, we're just going to use some tape, hold it in place. You see that thing needs to spring open still. Off of here. Wipe it off now, I won't have to deal with it later. Alright. Check her with the square. Almost perfect. All right. Well, that's it for this here for now. Let that set up, and then we'll see how to put fillets in here. Because that corner right there, it's going to be really sharp. When you go to take it out of the sand, it's going to be very delicate. A really tight 90 degree corner made out of sand is not very durable. So we'll fix that up. Alright, so next step is to put fillets in. So in these corners here, you know, a fillet is just a radius on the inside of a corner. So what we're going to use is Dram's Rock Hard Water Putty. And I've had this can for a little while, but I really haven't used it much, so we're going to give it a whirl. You know what, let me study up on the instructions here. Alright, so it looks like it's one part putty. Or powder to, is that what it was? Let's see here. Three parts powder to one part water. So this is a tablespoon. This is our least favorite tablespoon, so it's become a shop tool now. You can see why I don't like it so much. I'll strike it off, and it wants to push the whole lot of it right out of the spoon. Kind of too shallow. Alright. So that's 3 tablespoons of powder. Now we can go with some more than that, I think. So this is like an 8-pound can, but I figured I'd get the small one just to try it out, see how I like it. Alright, that's certainly enough to get started. This stuff is supposed to, it says it sets quickly, but we'll see how that goes. And then it says just add water little by little. Consistency that you want. And that is way too dry right there. Water. And now I've added too much water. So we'll go add some more powder. Thank you. you can actually do little castings with this stuff here too. Make you a mold out of silicone or something like that, or whatever, I guess. And pour it in there. I guess this is kind of a plaster product or something. Base, gypsum base. I guess you can put either milk or vinegar in here and that will retard the curing time. Alright, let's see how this goes here. Pretty good. This excess off of here. Over here. Too. Right there's a good one. Oh, totally off frame too, huh? Alright. You can't see. I just want to get that little excess right there out. Stuff is starting to set already, so. Those they weren't kidding around when they said it sets fast. finished in time. If not, got another bucket over here still to go. You can do this stuff with Bondo too. It works pretty good, but nice thing about this stuff is it's a powder, so it stores pretty well. Most putties that you find, Bondo included, they're, you know, they're already mixed, ready to go, and they got kind of shelf life, so I don't use very much. A can of Bondo, even a little one, lasts me a really long time. Sorry, I've got the camera kind of on the wrong side here, but I'll try to show you this better later if I can on something else. Stuff that squirts out around the edge past your knife, it's always good to get all that off of there. You know, you think, oh, yeah, I'll just come back and sand it later, but trust me, it's much easier to scrape it off right now than it is later. set a little bit. It's beginning to feel a little bit more clay-like. I think that's probably about as good as we're going to get it right now. I'm going to have to work into those little corners where all three of these fillets come together a little bit. That's going to be challenging, I suppose. If it was easy, everybody would be doing this, I guess. Oh no. Put my tool off here. And we'll just let that cure. Alrighty. Hey. We'll be back on the next step. So for the next step here, I want to make a tool that goes with the pattern. The pattern's pretty much complete. We're just waiting for these fillets to cure here. Then we'll sand and paint this and get it all sort of finished off. More or less, that's done. That's the way the part was going to come out of the sand looking, just like that. But if they say this is the molding board, they put that down, mold it up, when they flip it over, all this stuff under here is going to be all full of sand. So when they flip it over, all you're going to see is just this little knife edge here on these two points. So that means that the molder is going to have to dig out all this sand here. You know, and he's going to be scratching away at the pattern, and you know, that's going to add some wear and tear to it. But you know, it's taking him time to do that. And also he'll have to part down on this face here too, to get that exposed so they can pull this out. So we're gonna make a tool that actually will sort of eliminate pretty much all that. So we're gonna cut out a piece that this here will fit on, about yay wide, about that long or so. So we can set this here. We're gonna cut some triangles. This is just a scrap that will fit right into here, really nice. And we're gonna leave it stick proud. We're gonna glue it down to the board. We're going to put a big draft on this thing, a lot of taper, so it comes out real easy. Put one on each end, and then under here, we've got another undercut. So we're going to take this piece here, and we're going to rip it at a 45, so it'll fit underneath there. We'll glue that down. And that should need very little work. Probably we'll have to put a little draft out here at the end. And I think that will probably finish up the follower board. So I'll do a little bit of layout work here and we'll be back. All right, we're back. So if you can see here, this was just a piece of scrap that I had glued together an eternity ago. I don't even know when. It's been a very long time, but I'm trying to do this with not having to buy any new wood. So anyway, I've laid out two triangles here. Tried to be as economical as I could with the wood. I left myself just the littlest bit of a room right here so my saw kerf will fit in there. And we're going to go ahead and cut this apart. All right. So one of the nice features of this vise is that I can actually tip it up this direction. And you can swivel it. What else can you do? Oh, you can actually unlock this here, and it'll tip this direction. So you can actually grab things that are not square, which of course is doing patterns. You know, you always have stuff with draft on it, so it's always good for that. Anyway, these are really handy. So if you're ever going to get into pattern making, this is the exact tool you want to find. Wish I could remember the name of the antique ones that are out there. But they're really expensive. Kind of a collectible market for those things. I'm going to grab a chisel. And go ahead and throw a little notch on here if you get started. Nice thing about this, I got a line here and also got a line there, so I can sight both those lines at the same time. That'll help me get this cut square. Come on. There we go. Cut some more waste off here. Let's see, maybe a bit better, I think, to cut this way. Okay, give ourselves a notch. This takes so little time to do, I do it most of the time, even if I probably don't even really need that accuracy, but you know, it's always good to try to saw right to your lines too if you can. You just save yourself some work later, you know, trying to sand or plane it down just a little tiny bit. It's easier to just cut it perfectly, right? Alright. One part. Now let's cut the waste off of this one. Soft spot right there. that's my line a little bit. See if I can fix it. I got around that corner anyway. Of course, that's going to button right up into the fillet, so. Times people that have never used hand tools, they think, oh, you know, they're slow and whatnot. But a lot of times, you can just lay out a line and saw the line, you can see there's just a little shadow of a line left there. Sometimes it's faster to just pick up a saw and just cut something, you know. And you got to be confident in your ability to cut square, but the only way you get that is by practicing, you know, and using the hand tools a lot. At any rate. And then, you know, I could have put it in a miter box or something, I suppose, to get that, but let's just see how they fit. Alright, now, I put witness marks on these. Single line on this side, two lines on that side, so that'll orient these parts where they can fit just like that. But remember, we got that fillet in there, so we're going to have to nip off this corner a little bit. Everybody's favorite tool in the shop. That one there. Oh, I'm getting ready to cut on my piece instead on my pinch hook. Fit in there pretty good. So, take off just a little bit more. I don't want to leave a big old gap. The better this fits, the less finishing work the molder has to do once he's got it in the sand. Call that one good. Now we gotta fit this one here. Right up in there. So from the corner here. Really can't stress enough how important it is to have good sharp tools. When they get dull, they just start tearing the wood fiber and cause a lot of frustration. You keep them good and sharp though, they'll work really good for you. A little bit more of that. Thank you. face opposite of the witness mark, the face that's going to be out here, we want to kind of put a... This needs to angle that direction, so I'm going to go back over here. I've got that rounded already, so that's no big deal. Sand it, I guess, and clean this all up a little bit more. But anyway, we're going to plane some draft onto that. And I want to leave maybe just a quarter of an inch or so over here. So go back to the pattern maker's button. Alright, so we'll take this plane here. We're going to kind of hog a lot of this off here. This guy here, you could remove way too much too quick here if you're not careful. When I think of what a power tool guy would have to do something like this, he'd probably have to come up with some kind of a board. They could run through a joint or like a planer at an angle, so he could put that on there, and that's sure sounds like an awful lot of work for something that's probably only a one-time job, unless you're making this all the time. This stuff is just easier with a hand tool. And I got nothing against power tools, that's for sure. And there's not much left to grab right there. Close now. Oops. Smoothing plane, some lines on here just so we can kind of see where we're going. Over the first few passes there, we'll be able to see ridges. This is all scooped. This is where having a little special planing jig might be handy. Some of the 45 that I could just wedge into. I should make myself one of those, I guess. Plus, I'm kind of crushing the tip of this. Alright, give me a minute here. Let me see if I can't figure out some way of holding this a little bit better. Alright. It just took me a few seconds here, and I had this as a little scrap of stuff I had cleaned down the quarter inch. Took a couple of cuts in it, and we'll put it down with some of these brass braids. These are good because in case you get out of control with your plane, you know, that won't do too much damage to the blade. Oh, I suppose we can be picky and put square on here. Once I got this made, now I'll have this tool here for doing planing work on little small 45 pieces for whatever reason. Done today. What? Boy, what kind of klutz nailed that thing? Alright. Anyway. Right there looks pretty good. They call this a planing stop. A lot of times you would just have a little piece like that and you'd be working on, say, something like this. A lot of times what I'll use is these bench dogs. Push one up. And the nice thing about these, they're infinitely variable. You can poke it up that high, or you could butt up a piece of wood against that and then just run your plane along there. That works real good. Happens that I needed one of the 45 today. Alright. Come down a little bit more on this side than over there. I think I got it though. Alrighty. Cleaned up pretty good. You can see how, I mean, you could push the bench along probably before you move that. Or at least the vise tightened up. Plenty of draft on that piece. Okay, we got that one there. Plane all that off. Back to our scrub plane. Knock some more junk off the table. Neat thing about this, because it's got that scooped, really rounded blade. If you plane in the same spot twice, the second cut it doesn't cut anything. So really, you can't cut too deep. At least not in one spot. Anyway, you can. Definitely cut too deep, but yeah, just gotta be a good operator. guess really this tool was probably more of like a house carpenter's tool than a fine cabinetry type person back in the days. They would use it for if you're fitting moldings to the wall. Sometimes you need to remove a bunch of stock out the back so you can fit it to where it lays perfectly flat to an irregular shape. And you've got a hand plastered wall. It's not likely to be dead flat. Trim carpenters were always the highest paid carpenters, aside from cabinet makers. That's a different trade entirely, really. They had to work, and they still do this to this day. Conditions where, you know, nothing is perfect. The walls are not right, they're not square, not plumb. All kinds of problems from the workman's point of view. You can't really tell any of this by just looking at the wall. But when you start trying to put moldings on there, it better look flat and square and plumb. So the guys that were good at that, they got paid more. And you can see where I'm cutting the peaks off of the scoops here. Benefit of hand tool work is, aside from this is kind of fun compared to running some wailing screaming machine, it doesn't take up nearly as much room. I mean, I could do almost any of the work I need on this workbench, and it's I don't think it's quite 6 feet long. But if you had a table saw and you need to cut a piece of wood, I mean, if it's a 5 foot board, you're going to have 5 feet before the blade and 5 feet after the blade. That's you can eat up a lot of space really fast. Alright, so we got the taper, plane on those. You can see the profile there. So this lays nice and flat, and bevels this way. So, time to go back to the screaming machines, I guess. We've got to cut out this board over here. Make us a little plate that we can attach all these pieces to. And we also got to cut those little 45 pieces. Alright. Let's set it up over at the saw.
Okay. So if I make one cut off of this thing here, I've already got the saw sort of set up where I think I need to make the cut. It'll be plenty long enough to make both pieces that I need. So I'm just going to take one cut all the way down to the end here, and that'll be that for this. I'm doing this first because that plywood cuts a lot better with the crosscut blade. And I got to make a rip cut, so it's already in here. So why change it just to change back? It a little extra thick right here because the feather edge like this is real delicate, so I'm gonna glue this down to the board, so that's fine, but this is gonna be probably not right there, so Anyway. Okay. Switch it over to the crosscut blade, and we're going to cut the base for this thing. All right. So I'm ready to cut this piece up. I already got it kind of marked out. So I'm going to cut it at 90 degrees, then we'll put the draft on it here in a second. Make sure I'm cutting this piece the right way. Okay. Alright, now I'm gonna tip the saw blade over, oh, let's say 15 degrees. Now with that, let's go like 20 degrees. And that should give us plenty of draft. We kind of don't want to leave a feather edge here. Not too much of one. Alright. Okay, a couple of cuts on this setting. Pretty good, except I got one little splinter chipped out in between the layers, but that's alright, we'll just put a little bit of putty in there. Alright, let's go back in the shop and we'll see about putting all those pieces onto this board. Alright, I ended up having to sharpen this portioner a bit, so see if we can make this hole a little bit faster. Let's go. Halfway. It's always good to drill into a piece of scrap on the backside. Give you a nice clean cut on the exit, otherwise it'll blow out. So you have it just, you know, over open air. Still not cutting quite as good as it should. But. All
glue, veneers crisscrossing back and forth. It's, I don't know if this style of a bit was really designed for that sort of work. Anyway, so that's how you drill a hole with a brace. You actually lean on it with your forehead while you're drilling, put pressure down into the cut. Well, there we go, there's a couple of nice holes, and that should make it easy to pick up. Alright, let me clean this all up. I'm going to make quite a mess now. Alright, I'm going to go ahead and put this thing here to the use a second time already. You know, we don't like square corners, so I'm going to put a little chamfer on here. And this is certainly a lot easier than trying to hold it by hand. Digging in a little bit. Okay. There we go. Hold it that way. Yep. Well, this is a useful little appliance we've made. Thing with this one here, and then we'll sand it a little bit and kind of round it up. This is slightly awkward because of the draft that's got on here. That's not too bad. Alright, we'll hit that with a little sandpaper. I already sanded this bottom edge. Probably should clean up this. Needs to be sanded a little more. So we'll do that. Sand the bottom, or the, well, mating surface. It's always good to have nice, fresh, clean wood. That way any dust or oil or anything that might have gotten on there doesn't interfere with the glue strength. So anyway, we're going to do a little bit of sanding, and then we'll come back again. Alright. So, we're all ready to glue up. And, hold on a moment. I don't know my own strength. Alright. What we're going to do is glue these triangles on first. And then I'm going to have to do a little bit of work on that other piece. Make sure you get your bevels going the right direction here. That one goes on that side. So I'm going to show you how to do a rub joint. So rub joint, you just spread you a little bit of glue on here. It's actually really easy, but nice thing, even layer. I've got some lines down here that I want to end up on. I push this down and wiggle it around a little bit, kind of rubbing it back and forth. It's forcing the glue out of there, and I can feel it starting to drag a little bit. You know, get to the point here, it'll actually sort of almost just seize right on. There, that's it. Right there. Alright. Nip off the excess. And this is actually a really handy technique, because once it's set on there, it's actually pretty durable as far as like bumping into it or something like that, you know. Okay, so we'll leave that one alone for a little bit. Put this one here on. And that's long grain to long grain, so that's going to be a really strong joint once the glue sets, so we won't need to worry about any other fasteners or anything like that. There was a time when a cabinet maker, metal hardware is expensive. You got to have a blacksmith make your nails and screws and stuff for you. It was just too expensive. So they would use wooden pegs and all kinds of things. And, you know, with the proper joints, all that stuff is, in some situations, better than a mechanical, you know, a metal fastener. This off of there. Slip just a little bit. Well, in 100 years, whoever goes and looks at the bottom of my bench is going to be horrified at the amount of glue that's been wiped off onto it. Alright, I just want to test the pattern on here and just verify that this is actually going to fit how I put it. We don't mess anything up in the processor. Alright, I think that'll work pretty good there. Yeah, so see this taper comes up and just kind of almost disappears right there. Same thing on this side. It's close enough for what we're trying to accomplish here. Alright, so we're going to turn the camera off. Well, kind of screwed up here, but not unsalvageable. I left this little parallel face on here thinking, I don't know what the heck I was thinking, but I was definitely wrong. So what I need to do is, this is going to lay like this, and I need to, you know, trim it off here this way a little bit. So we'll just do that with block plane. Oh, it's sitting right here. All right, no big deal. Wax it up. Good. That'll work. Now we'll do this one here, same way. Again, this ain't a really fussy angle, it just needs to be more than 1.5 degrees or so. Crush the point of that. Grab it too tight. Get some pencil mark on here so I can see where I'm. Okay, next step, and these triangle pieces are still drying on there. What we need to do, we need to cut this way across here, just so we get draft on the ends of this. I just sawed that off with a small cross cut, so we'll grab a pencil and we'll just kind of more or less mark out where we need to trim it. From about
there, up there, and I better put a match mark. There's a one on that side, put two over here. Okay, mark out this piece while we're over here. Move this out of the way so we don't damage our drying stuff over here. Alright. See if I can do this without disturbing the camera. So, we're just gonna kind of line up, leave a little excess there. I don't think that's going to make it. Is this thing dull? Alright, I'm going to have to get a mallet, I think, here. I'm gonna have to point it up against the wall here of some sort. If I do that, I can actually cut it the way I want it to. Yeah. All right. Tore the green out quite a bit. Well, you can see, cut it off, but not very cleanly. I'm going to try it on this other side here to see if we can't do it in maybe some steps. Chopping on this bench hook with the chisel. So it's no big deal if it gets nicked and dinged a little bit. Better this than the top of my bench. Check over here, make sure it's all good. Yep, that's working so far. Alright. Let's do this one here. Like we did on the second side, I guess. Results are a lot better. There. I don't know if I can get this where you guys can see what I'm doing. This is a very difficult piece to hold. It's
facets all over it. Test fit this one over here. Make sure that's good. Yeah. Well, that's beautiful. Alright. Bring this back here. You can see what we're doing again. Alright, so now you can see. And you can see that we got that taper there. So when this is all put together, this will all come out of the sand very easily. Let's go ahead and get some glue. We'll glue these guys here down. We'll need to do just a little bit more cleanup and planing work on this. Piece I'm fixing on here right now. Spread the glue. Rub this joint together just like we did on the other parts. It's nice to be able to have the pattern in here so I can, as I rub this together, I can make sure it fits right on to the pattern. Notice sometimes when you wipe that glue into the corner, it'll almost make a fillet for you. Although, you know, not very much of one. Alright. Glue on this other one here. Almost done with this now. It'll just be a little bit of a paint job. And as soon as I get some money, that's the biggest problem. Get some money and we take this down to the foundry and we can cast up some of these. I haven't really thought too much about the size of this thing here, but I wonder if it'll, if I can bolt it to my faceplate from my lathe. To do, sometimes it's convenient to hold a piece that way. Should stick. So, like I said, one really complicated piece here. Just making a silly follower board, but you know. We're just here having fun anyway. Alright, that's it. We'll show you the rest here in a little while. Alright, I just had some scrap from this here. I wanted to kind of reinforce this to make it a little stronger, so we're going to glue these blocks in there. And we're going to do our rub joint again. Still gonna need to make something to, well, we might need to register the stuff on there real good. The pattern, to make sure the pattern sets, you know, laterally and we don't get too far one direction or the other. Nice thing about this technique is you don't need to clamp done. It's pretty much already starting to catch, really. Alright. Still gotta wait for this to dry here before I dare do it, but I need to plane down it. Well, I want to, I could let it go, but I want to plane the top of this down a little bit when the pattern sits on here. This back edge, yeah, there's a step right there. Well, we don't really need that step, so I'll just plane that flat, and that'll be a less, you know, delicate thing in the foundry. They're knocking stuff around, you know. It's not the ballet, you know. People trying to get stuff done, so. But that little edge will get beat up really easy, so. I don't know, how wide is this? I got it on there the right direction here. Yep, that's the right spot. Yeah, I need to put a. I'll do it right now. I'll put a match mark right here, like this. So we know where. Which way that thing is supposed to go on there. Later on, we'll come up with something. Probably put a different little stripe of color or something on one end, that way they know to put it on a particular way. I don't think it's going to matter too much, but alright, I think that's good for now. Okay, I just split some pieces out with the chisel and put a little glue on them. I put the piece on here, put the pattern on here where I wanted it, and then I just reached inside and kind of squeezed it together. So that's actually not even dry yet, but I won't need to mess with that too much. What I want to do now, this is set good enough that I can plane this off here. This one without crashing into the camera. You can see I already got a little dent on that corner. Right. Take that corner away a little bit too. paper. I'd say we're done with as far as construction is. I think that's going to be pretty much about the end of this this little footage here. Probably I'll paint everything, get it all cleaned up, and then I'll give you a picture of the completed product. Got a little bit of fill work to do here, but you know, none of that is really all that fascinating to watch. You see it once, you've seen it before, you know. Anyway, let me put the pattern back in there. You have one last look at it. Find my spot. There we go. All right. Well, looks pretty good to me. Go up to the foundry, I think I may bring the camera along and have a little talk with the foundryman while we're there. All right, that's it for this.